Your Hormonal Story, a podcast about real women and real stories, breaking down the stigma about hormonal conditions. Join us for an informal chat about women's health, the struggles, the solutions. I'm Jeff Butterworth, naturopath and women's health specialist for over 25 years. Everyone has a story, and we'd love to help you with your unique story. On this episode of Your Hormonal Story, we're chatting with Jodi, and we have a fabulous chat about menopause, perimenopause, how she had a really difficult time during these phases. But what I loved about this chat was how Jodi's got a really positive mental attitude, and she's adopted a lot of dietary and lifestyle changes, exercise, and how she implemented that into her life to improve not only her menopause and perimenopausal symptoms, but her overall symptoms, symptoms of bloating, a parasitic infection, and how she's overcome that largely through diet and lifestyle and some of our Happy Healthy You products. So if you've got menopause, you're going through this transition with perimenopause, then this is a really fabulous episode. And there's lots of great information there to help you with your journey with your hormonal story. Welcome to Your Hormonal Story. This week, we're chatting to Jodi. Welcome.
Thank you. Hello. Nice to meet you all.
So normally in our episodes of Your Hormonal Story, we're chatting to women with really quite chronic conditions, long-standing conditions, but Jodi's I wouldn't say suffering because you've managed to find a great solution, but Jodi's been through perimenopause and menopause. So we're going to chat to Jodi today about everything about menopause, and hopefully I can give anyone listening some tips and tricks on how to safely and naturally navigate menopause. So welcome again, Jodi. Tell me a little bit about when your symptoms first started with, particularly with, I suppose, perimenopause, because perimenopause is that phase before menopause.
Yeah, which I think was actually the worst, to be honest. I thought I was really sick. I had aches and pains that I'd never had before. I do have arthritis and all my joints flared up more than ever. The hip pain was insane. Like, I thought, what have I done to my hips and my back? And when I started researching and realizing that it was pretty much perimenopause, and I had like a period in November 2020, and I didn't have one for like over a year. So I sort of figured that it must be starting. So back to the perimenopause. Yeah, just, I think the insomnia and everything hit me really quick, but it was more the aches and pains. And I didn't really think about it. And then I thought, oh, I've got to start taking something. And I didn't want to do anything medicinal. It's just not what I do. And I discovered happy hormones, started taking them, and noticed a difference. Then I thought I was okay. And once again, didn't really know the whole process, and didn't really, my mum had hysterectomy very young, so she hasn't had really any symptoms her whole life, which is very lucky for her. So I didn't, you know, she's like, sorry, I can't help you. And then I went off the happy hormones and then went, oh no, went back on them and realized that I was in full swing. And I went to the doctor and they said, you're peri. So yeah, that's how it started. But then I went through to menopause quite quickly, which was, I don't know if it was good or not, because it was a few months of, it was pretty horrendous. I started then getting all the really chronic insomnia, the brain fog, my memory, which has always been great. I couldn't remember what certain words were. Just felt sick, like constantly every morning. So upped the happy hormones, got the happy liver, got the happy calm, because I had anxiety, which I'd never had. And I've been on them ever since. And then apparently, according to my bloods or whatever, but I'm still not really sure, I got through menopause in a year. And now I'm post. But happy hormones saved me, because it was pretty bad for about 5 or 6 months. Awful. Yeah. It just wasn't me.
And I'm assuming that before perimenopause, your cycle was pretty good symptom-wise.
Yeah, I was pretty lucky growing up. I've never been someone that's had a lot of issues. It was always on track. Look, I took the pill when I was younger, like most people did. I hadn't had that. Gosh, I stopped that when I was about 28. I suffer from migraines, so I just feel things like that wasn't good for me. So my cycle was fine. It was good. And I must admit that I started getting pain as I got older, sort of before my peri. I think I'd never had pain and felt so sick with a period. And that's when I thought this something must be up, because I'd never experienced that before.
It's an interesting one, because perimenopause, if I rewind maybe 10 years ago, perimenopause really wasn't something that was spoken about. It was always just hormonal stuff. But now there's, thankfully, that there's a lot more information around perimenopause. But a very common story we hear is women all of a sudden, you know, just their whole world changes because everything was fine. And as you mentioned, the brain fog, the aches and pains, their irregular cycles. Did your migraine headaches become more frequent?
They did. And the weird thing is that they're now better. So, which is great. They definitely did. I can't even explain the sickness. The woman listening will understand. It's like it came out of nowhere. And I thought I was really ill and was scared to go to the doctor, to be honest, because I was scared of what they were going to find. So quite relieved that it was the good old horrible menopause or peri.
But a lot of women, it takes a lot longer because the symptoms can be so severe, and often doctors are just clueless when it comes to hormones. Yep. So it can be quite hard to diagnose. Interestingly, migraine headaches, you may not have realized this, but are very commonly associated with cyclical hormonal changes. So not always, there's a lot of different causes of migraines. So, but that's great now that your hormone levels have settled down, that you're not getting them as frequently or severely. So, okay. All right. So I'll just put a little bit of perspective for a few of the women listening when it comes to this whole perimenopause and menopausal journey. So that usually taps in around or starts to occur around the age of 40. So it can be before or after. But what happens is that your progesterone levels start to drop. And that is one of the main sort of things that can be associated with the aches and pains. So as that, and what often happens, and you work in an integrated medical center, and you probably a lot of the doctors are doing this there, is they do the blood tests, your progesterone levels are low. So the first prescription is progesterone. And that can be great to alleviate those symptoms of aches and pains and the symptoms of perimenopause. So for the women going through this journey, very high chance that you're going to be offered progesterone as probably one of the first treatment options. Now, it's you kind of got to put it into context and make that decision yourself. Are these symptoms that bad that it warrants some really urgent treatment? Or do you think that because what's going to happen is the progesterone then disrupts what your body's actually trying to do, because it's reducing the progesterone levels naturally. You've probably seen me talking about this in our groups and that kind of thing. So I'm neither here nor there, but because when it comes to women's bodies, you're going to make the choice of what is the best option for you. But the problem with progesterone, because it then slows that menopausal journey and potentially stops it, then you can be adding 10, 20 years onto this process. Whereas if we take you as an example, you resisted that and decided to use natural medicines, herbs in terms of happy hormones and happy liver and so forth, then what you're doing is you're supporting that natural process. So you're letting your body sort of walk through that naturally, and then your progesterone levels drop, your estrogen levels drop, and then your adrenal glands kick in and produce your alternate hormone system. So your body has done that beautifully. And it's done that because you probably haven't had too many hormonal issues earlier in life. So, and the other thing that's a prerequisite for this to happen is having healthy adrenal glands. So I'm not sure if you're a stressful sort of person, but generally women that have had a lot of stress in their lives have difficult menopause, because it's your adrenal glands that take over your hormone production. So as your ovaries shut down, the adrenals take over. If they don't do that, then you get a lot of the symptoms, and also you get a lot of the associated menopausal weight gain, because your body, if your adrenals aren't doing it, and this is a bit of a hack, and we can talk about this in a minute for you, is a little bit of a hack of this menopausal weight gain is if the body needs these hormones, so it has different ways of making them. Primarily, it wants to make them from your adrenal glands. And again, these are more androgen male-based hormones because it doesn't want these reproductive hormones anymore because you're not fertile. They're too stimulatory for your system. So it shifts into these more androgen-based hormones that actually then convert into estrogen as well and small amounts of progesterone, but that's a different story. But if your adrenals aren't doing that, then another way your body does that is through fat cells. So, and this is where we see this middle-age spread occur, is that's the body's way of trying to produce more of these alternate hormones and estrogen from fat cells. So, but you've because your adrenal glands seem to be working pretty well, you've transitioned through quite nicely.
Well, yeah, I think you helped me. So thank you. I listened to your podcast when I was sort of in the midst of feeling awful. And look, everyone's different, but I took from it exactly what you just said. And once I understood why the body was getting rid of things, you know, my body no longer needs all that. I don't know, my brain sort of computed and I felt a lot better about it. And so I accepted it a bit better and knew that I just had to write it out. Yeah, so that, thank you. but I had the weight gain and it's weird. I'm quite a healthy, active, very active person. And it was like all of a sudden, I reckon within 2 to 3 weeks, I put on 2 kilos just like that. And no reason why. And then I couldn't explain it. And talking to my friends, they're the same. Yeah, so I just try to keep that at bay. Look, I'm fine, but I noticed it.
Yeah. Well, I certainly don't want to make light as well of what you went through, because that was, it's a really life-changing situation where you go from feeling fine to having to deal with all the stuff that's going on. So you've navigated that now. And what you'll probably find is, I'll give you some other tricks in a minute, but there's a phase where, yes, you will have some weight gain, but after a couple of years being post-menopausal, if you keep doing what you're doing, your body will kind of reset. And there's a few things that you can do. It's very much also about getting your insulin levels nicely balanced. So sugar is a really big no-no for in this stage of life. For hot flushes, having sugar will actually trigger hot flushes, but also that way we call it insulin sensitivity. The body becomes less sensitive to insulin at this time because the whole endocrine system is involved in this process. So your obviously your hormone levels are changing, but that influences your adrenals become involved and also your pancreas with your sugar levels, because if you remember premenstrually, you're probably used to get sugar cravings and those kind of things. Your sugar levels are really closely linked to hormones, so really watching your sugar levels at this stage. And if you can do that and get your body more sensitive to insulin levels, and there's a herb in happy hormones called gymnema, which is really good for helping to regulate sugar levels. So if you keep on with that, that'll help. And there's another one, which is a really simple one called chromium. It's a mineral, and magnesium, which help to sensitize your body. And a little one just called, which is really easy to take, is apple cider vinegar with meals can really help with insulin sensitivity. And that's, if you get your insulin levels sort of balanced, then that can really help with that weight gain. And then if you then try intermittent fasting is something that you can do as well. So just reducing that eating window, your body becomes more sensitive to the insulin, and then you should lose a few kilos from there. So, but it's a very real thing, as you found out.
It is. I do all of the above. I have apple cider vinegar. I fast most days. You know, as I said, everyone's different. Maybe I was lucky. I've stopped all my bloating. That's where I feel better. I sort of accepted the weight, thought, oh, well, it's a few kilos, deal with it. It was more the bloating. And right. Now that I've balanced everything out and with the happy liver, happy greens, everything, I feel so much better and stop the carbs and the sugar.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So you're doing everything we say in the group. So you're kind of our perfect.
Thank you. Well, thanks to you.
Well, it's actually, these are just naturopathic principles that we tell patients every day in and out. But if you're not seeing a naturopath or under the guidance of a naturopath, you often don't hear these things. So this is what we're about, is education. And And for those that are listening to this that don't know, we've got a very big private community of women, nearly 180,000 women now. So Jodie's part of that community. And she, you've obviously learned from, we're posting daily in there different bits of advice. And so that's great. You've learned from that. All right, well done. The other important thing, and you've already alluded to this as well, is a lot of, well, first of all, a lot of people think that happy hormones is a menopause product. First of all, it's not. It's a broad spectrum hormonal kind of regulator. So we've got teens to postmenopausal women take it. It's a tonic for your system. So then obviously it helps in menopause. But the other thing that it's this transition that you need to understand from being actively fertile to perimenopause and menopause. There's this journey that the body goes through. Now, the women that have the best journeys are the ones that start looking at this very early in perimenopause. So you obviously had perimenopausal symptoms, but just for any woman listening, if you're in and around that age of 40, don't wait until you get hot flushes then to do something about it, because you really, what you've got to do is you've got to prepare those adrenal glands to transition. And that's the key thing that anyone's listening is get your adrenal glands healthy. So that's managing stress levels, it's eating well, it's making sure getting rid of the sugar and the refined carbs and all that kind of stuff. So really, really important. And then if you need that tonic to help your body regulate, because that's what happy hormones does, it works on your hormonal control center in the brain. It signals to the brain to regulate. So in itself, it does nothing. It's more just signaling to the body to balance hormones. Whereas HRT is like a steam train coming in, just kind of bombarding the system with hormones and putting a big blanket over it, but effectively slowing that journey. Okay. Yeah. So tell me, did you change your diet? You were saying you've changed it a little bit with the weight loss, but tell me a little bit about what you did there.
I stopped drinking. I wasn't a huge drinker, but, you know, like everyone, actually stopped wine a few years ago. So I just have vodka sodas. But even that, I couldn't even have one. The flushes were horrendous. So I stopped the drinking for at least 6 weeks and noticed the difference. Eventually, I could have the odd one and I'm fine. Sugar, definitely. And just trying to get your sleep.
Yeah.
Sleep was hard. Geez, I slept with an ice pack with a cold flannel next to my bed, and you'd wake up because it wakes you up before you have one and you're trying to cool off, and it's pretty hard. That went on for quite a few months, but definitely if I didn't drink, kept off the sugar and exercised, I felt a lot better.
Yeah.
Definitely helped.
It's just such powerful advice, and we say it every single day, but it can be hard to change. And it's certainly the other one I just throw on top of that is coffee. So it's all the things often women, sugar, coffee, alcohol, exercise, stress, managing stress, the big five when it comes to menopause. And some women can get away with it, but it's, if you just do those alone, it certainly helps with the flushes. But what we find, you really need just that happy hormones on top of that, because it's just that such a, you know, strong transitionary phase just to kind of bring everything together. It's kind of like a catalyst to bring it together. So, okay. And why the vodka and tonic, was there a reason why you went from wine?
I don't have bloating anymore. I've had gut issues my whole life. I've got a parasite that doesn't go away. It doesn't make me sick anymore, touch wood. But I just stopped wine. I got into a real bit of a fitness craze a few years ago and felt the best by not drinking for a long time, and then just stopped the wine and just have vodka soda.
Yeah.
So, okay. Yeah, definitely. You know, it is hard for a lot of people. And look, I'm a social person. I'll still have the odd glass of bubbles if it's a friend's birthday or something, but I do half bubbles and half soda water. Yeah. I'm known as the nerd drinker. So I don't care. It gets me through and I can still enjoy my life without it not being there. But it wasn't too hard for me. Others, I know it's harder, but if you can just do it and stick at it, you'll be okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Vodka and soda, if you're going to drink, is certainly the best option. So you figured that one out. The the gut issues, we'll talk a little bit about that as well, because often coming into this phase, perimenopause, menopause, your digestive capacity reduces. And as naturopaths, we always say the first place you look at in healing any condition is your digestion. So what happens is your hydrochloric acid levels tend to drop, which are in the stomach. And as the levels of hydrochloric acid drop, then your pancreatic enzymes drop. And essentially, you're not digesting your food as well as what you should be. And that can then cause the bloating. Then the liver becomes involved in that process. And that's why actually happy liver is so good, is because it contains digestive enzymes. So almost instantly, if you're getting bloating within a few days and even a few hours, so, you know, if I've eaten something that doesn't agree with me and I have some happy liver, straight away you feel better because of those digestive enzymes in there. So the liver plays a really important part in that. And then the other important part of that, and you're taking the happy greens, is building that a healthy microbiome. So you mentioned you've got this parasite. The happy greens are probably doing playing a big role in that by putting the live probiotics back in there. And there's a lot of research coming out now on the difference between live probiotics and dried probiotics. And dried probiotics play a role, but because they're essentially denatured, it takes, you know, up to 36 hours for them to wake up, where often they're out of the body. And then they put an enteric coating on them, which means it's like to protect it from the hydrochloric acid in the stomach. So they often just don't break down at all. Whereas something like happy greens is live, or happy turmeric has the live probiotics. So they get to work straight away. But the research is showing that fermented foods, so essentially the same thing, have a much better effect of repopulating and reestablishing a healthy microbiome, because there's a broad spectrum of bacteria in fermented foods. So not just lactobacillus and bifidobacterium, which are the common probiotics. There's a real broad spectrum of bacteria. But what you're doing is you're giving the food source for those bacteria all in one. So the bacteria, like if I take sauerkraut, for example, the bacteria that are in sauerkraut feed on the cabbage. So you're giving them a food source. Whereas when you take a probiotic by itself, it's like taking refugees and putting them in a new country, but not feeding them. And they just essentially die off. And that's what happens with probiotic capsules. So keeping that balance right. And parasites are opportunistic. So if you let them get out of control, then they will. So keeping them in control with more healthy bacteria. And the other thing is, which really, really important, is feeding your microbiome. So what they like to eat essentially are plant-based fiber. So fruits and vegetables, that's really what healthy bacteria live on. The bad bacteria that we don't want, the cause of bloating and candida and all these things, guess what? They feed on refined carbohydrates and sugar and alcohol. So that's why these populations overgrow. They're there for a reason, because you're giving them the food source that they, and they're actually helping you in a way. They're helping your body to metabolize those sugars and eat some of those sugars. But what we want are those bacteria that are beneficial and have this symbiotic relationship in our body to generate a good for our sleep, for our mood, for our hormones, for our immune system, anti-inflammatory and all that stuff. So the inflammation levels probably improve from also taking the happy greens, but changing your diet, getting rid of the alcohol and the sugar and all those things. So it's, you know, we've simplified what you've actually done when you were saying, but the impact on your health is huge. You're really working in a really holistic way. So hopefully that gives you a little bit of perspective on why you're feeling so much better now.
Well, the happy greens, and I've had so many probiotics, you know, for years because of my gut. And I could not believe the difference with the happy greens after 2 days, how much better I felt. I was like, wow, I've found it. I've finally got something that is just amazing. So if you have bloating and gut issues, give that a try. It's just the best ever.
My
husband loves it too.
But again, you've got to you know, everything that we do is sort of part of a system, and the women that struggle with our approach are the ones that typically they hear about it and they'll get 60 capsules of the happy hormones and they'll take that and they'll say it's not working. So, but it's all this other stuff. And what I'd like to get across to anyone listening to this that's going through menopause is your the degree of hormonal imbalance and how well you transition really depends on your overall health. It's not just, you know, just a hormonal thing. It's hormones are almost a symptom of what else is going on in your body. And if your body is balanced, then your body can regulate and go through that transition. If you're eating a lot of sugar, drinking alcohol regularly, 5 coffees a day, very heavily in the animal products, you're going to struggle and stress as well. And just taking happy hormones, it might help, but it's you really implementing these little things. And, you know, you've done it now, but it's, I don't want to make light of that as well, is it can be really difficult to go from here to here where you need to. And it's almost like, unfortunately for women, you're forced into a corner at this age, and you're given these two directions. Is one, don't change your diet and lifestyle and take HRT, and then you prolong the whole menopausal journey for 20 odd years and eventually you have to go through it anyway. Or you make those dietary and lifestyle changes and manage it from a natural way. And, you know, that's not for everyone, unfortunately. But obviously you've been interested in your health over the years you know, and you get all the positive side effects of it as well. So, you know. Tell me a bit about the fitness journey that you went through a couple of years ago.
I just thought I've got to look, as you get older, your body changes, you don't bounce back as fast and just things like that. So I actually did a program, a 12-week, and I could not believe the difference. I wasn't obsessive with it. I just stuck to good eating, which I'd kind of already done. So that was a good start, but it was more the exercise. And it's not full on exercise, you know, it's just, even if it was 20 minutes a day, I have a home gym, so I'm quite lucky there. So it was actually the Michelle Bridges that I did, and I had done it before. And all of the exercises in there are pretty straightforward, and a lot of other fitness programs have. It's just working on your core, working on your legs, and just being stronger. It wasn't about getting toned. It wasn't about getting, you know, like losing a load of weight. I had a goal of just getting toned, and it worked. And it was just even cleaner eating than what I had done. So it was amazing, and I felt the best I've ever felt. So I'm trying to get back into that now that I've come through the menopause thing. Last year it was kind of I did exercise still, but it, you know, it's hard, I won't lie. You're tired, you haven't slept well, you've got insomnia, and it was harder for me to get up and do my fitness, but I've always done something. So yeah, I'm back into it now and I feel great. But I do think that having the happy hormones, the happy calm, everything like that is just helping me with my journey. But the eating, the sleeping, the no alcohol, the coffee, keeping that, you know, I have one a day. I've always never really had more than that. I've been able to introduce that back in, which is nice, and I'm okay. So it's just taking that step. And once you do it, you don't really look back because you feel so fantastic. And I think it's helped with me getting through the menopause journey for sure. Definitely has.
Oh, 100%. Yeah. I cannot emphasize that enough. It's all about,
and I still felt awful. Like I really did feel horrible last year. It was pretty bad. I'm not gonna lie, people ask, oh wow, what's it like? I'm like, you know what, I was not prepared. I wish I had researched more. So if you can even research more, you said before that, you know, happy hormones isn't just for menopause women, teenagers are taking it. If you can just educate yourself on the body and what it does through stages of life, it makes such a difference just to understand it more. Because of my mum and not being able to sort of relate, I didn't know about insomnia or ears ringing, which I still have, weird little things like that, all the joint pain. I didn't know that was menopause. I thought that you got moody and crabby and your husband didn't like you for a while. That's the horror stories that you hear, which, hey, things happen. But my husband was amazing. I made him read happy hormone forums, and he's like, wow, that's you, that's what you're going through, mate. Yep. So if you can educate your family too, look, it doesn't have to be a big deal, but it's important that they understand you're not doing this on purpose.
There's a couple of things I'd like to just rehash on there. Is one, it just reiterate that exercise is, you know, there's a lot of studies that show exercise is really important. Obviously it's difficult when you got the full-blown hot flushes and those kind of things, but if you can continue with that. And exercise is You need to be getting your heart rate up. You need to be sweating. Is I see a lot of women thinking that they're going for a walk with a coffee in their hand is exercise. It's beneficial and it's great for releasing stress and stuff, but you've got to get your heart rate up. You've got to sweat, and that whole vasodilation of your blood vessels really helps with menopause. One. Two, there's this unfortunate catch 22 with sleep and hot flushes. So obviously if you're getting hot flushes every hour, it's really difficult to sleep. So that's why things like happy hormones, happy calm can be beneficial, magnesium. But sleep is also there's a lot of other triggers when it comes to sleep. So sleep is very much cyclical, and I've got podcasts and we talk a lot about sleep. But you know, making sure that your coffee is a big issue when it comes to sleep, alcohol, sugar, diet, exercise, all the same things keep popping up, right? Are really important to try and at least start with a healthy sleep pattern, because a lot of women haven't got healthy sleep patterns from perimenopause. And if you're not sleeping well, then you know that is probably the number one pillar when it comes to health, because that's when our body balances, it heals, it repairs. So just so important if you're not focused on sleeping. And one thing I always say is everything I do in my own health during the day is focused on getting a good night's sleep at night. So it's everything you do in your waking hours that influence your sleeping hours. So people can kind of put that into context there. The other thing that you touched on is, and this is what we're trying to promote, but I feel like we're losing a bit of a battle at the moment, is that menopause is a natural transitionary journey. And you said, you know, research, look at it. But I really feel like at the moment there's this disconnect and misunderstanding about what is actually happening. I never hear people talk. You know, the dialogue before was about the menopause journey and transition, but this whole transition word is gone. Now it's about preventing it and stopping it, and it's about HRT. And you know, certainly HRT has its place for certain women that are, as I said, don't want to make any dietary and lifestyle changes and or have chronically stressed adrenals. But I really want women to understand that it's a very normal, natural transition. Your body is not diseased. It's not dysfunctional. And the current rhetoric is all around, you know, menopause is a disease. They're not saying it directly, but that's the connotation to it is. And it's being spoken about more, but I kind of fear that it's not the right conversation. So, and when women go to search for information on menopause at the moment, what's being pushed straight in their face is HRT and not this. This is this journey. You need to make the dietary and lifestyle. Let's exercise. Let's eat well. It's just not in the conversation, unfortunately. Very often it's there a little bit, but you're a fantastic living example of yes, it was still difficult, but if you understand what's happening in your body, you can kind of, you know, reconcile that this is a short-term transition I go through, and then you come out the other side and you feel great, as opposed to, you know, this is going to, and we hear it all the time that women are in their 80s and still trying to get off HRT and still suffering from menopausal symptoms because it hasn't been managed properly right at the start. And the start is perimenopause. And that's what I'd love for anyone listening to take away from this. So.
It's definitely, I don't, as I said, it was pretty hard. It's a weird time, but don't be afraid of it. Once you learn about it and listen to your podcasts, you understand why, and it totally makes sense. And you've just got to ride it out. It's just once you can release everything that's no longer needed with your diet and sleeping and exercise, which is not that hard sometimes, plus the supplements to help you. It's I went through it. It wasn't great, but it was a short time. And I do believe that with my lifestyle and taking the happy hormones and everything, totally helped that. I've got friends that don't do that, and they've been going through it for a longer time and really suffering. You know, and everyone's different. So it's a strange conversation. Some people like to have it, some don't. So you just be careful what you say to some. You know, I don't want to upset anyone, but this is my life and this is my body, and I chose this path, and I'm glad that I did.
It's an interesting one with your friends that you're saying that is, you know, everyone's on different paths and strangely, people can get very emotive around treatment choices. And, you know, in online forums, when it comes to HRT and stuff, is women that are taking HRT can get really aggressive that, you know, this might, you know, it's we're just giving you the information that there's options out there. So at the end of the day, it's just, it's a choice and be happy with that choice that you make. What I find interesting as well is all the things that we associate that we tend to love, and this is something conversation we have often in the groups, is we say, you know, you need to cut back on the coffee, sugar, alcohol, and exercise more. And unfortunately, a lot of people relate to that as negative. So these are the things that I love. You know, I'm not going to do that because it's the only joy I have in my life. But the real ironic thing about that, they're the very same thing. They're the things that they enjoy, but they're the things that are making them miserable. So it's when you change that mindset that what you put in your mouth and what you how you treat your body, then you can start to lead what I always call a wellness lifestyle. And a lot of people, and this is just where people are at on that health journey, is if you can mentally shift from, you know, deprivation to education, deprivation to doing something positive for your body, then it changes. And you're very much in this wellness lifestyle and you're enjoying life and being eating well and exercising, and it's part of your joy. Whereas other people's joy is often alcohol. But what they are is, if anyone listening to this and you're in that phase, is these are coping tools, right? Whereas for you, your coping tools became doing the right things for your body. So often it's just that mental shift. And if you can get over that hurdle, then it becomes a lot easier. But it's changing, but you're probably in going back to your group of friends, is you're probably the minority. And you mentioned that you're the nerdy drinker or whatever. So it becomes this sort of social stigma, is everyone's doing this, but you're doing that. So you can become in the minority, which can be hard as well.
I'm going to leave it. It's me.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, I look after me, and that's important.
You can't fake health and well-being too. And me just looking at you, and you're radiating, and your happiness, and you look really well. You honestly do. Whereas people that sort of are not looking after their health, you know, you can see straight away. So everything you're doing, certainly stick at it, and it's gonna. And you know, you're making. And it's again, women are forced into this with menopause to make that choice. But you're 50. You've got another 20, 30, 40 years left to live in your life. And we're often, now's the time, and this is for men as well, is men are forced into this choice at this age of life, because men, this very real thing is it's called menopause, where men get a drop of testosterone levels and it makes them grumpy and put on weight and not sleep and all that similar thing. It's not as intense, obviously, as menopause, but it's the same for women, is men, when they're getting dropping testosterone levels, the cause is stress, it's alcohol, it's too much sugar, and it's not eating well. And it's this sliding door, which path do you choose? And do you want to live a healthy, happy life for the rest of your life? Or do you want to then, you're going to be forced into that medication route. And, you know, it's a choice. But I feel that people are not given that choice, you know, because they're just not told of, this is, you know, it's unfortunate, but it's just this way we are as a society.
I saw three doctors when I was going through it, you know, wondering what was going on. And all three, the first thing they said was HRT. And I said, it's not an option for me. My dad has blood clots and is now double amputee because of that. And I'm like, not going to take any risks to do with any medication, because, you know, what he has is hereditary, but not just because of that. I just have always sort of, with the gut issues, I found that medication is not for me. And the natural way is the way. And it's actually easier, I think, because you then get side effects from medications as well. And so that's horrible, and that adds to everything else. So yeah, definitely needs to be talked about a bit more. Options, as you said, having the option, and then people can make their own mind up and see what's best for them.
The problem is at the moment, and I wish I had the PR that the pharmaceutical companies have. The PR around HRT in the last 2 years has been phenomenal, particularly in the UK, actually. Is there's, you know, celebrities and everyone's raving about HRT, and everyone forgot about all the side effects and the dangers that are there. And they've just done this fabulous job. And to the point where most doctors, is exactly that, HRT, it's the, because it's the only tool in their medicine box, apart from antidepressants. Yeah. So this is why I really love for this kind of podcast and this information to get out there. Just to say, listen, this is an example, and we've got thousands and thousands of other examples like you as well, as you know, Jodi, of how it can also be done. So, and then you make that choice. But when you go to see your doctor for advice and the only advice you're getting is HRT, then that's not an option, right? So, and some people can't do that research, and you know, it's a big minefield, and you've got a couple of options. You go online and try and Google information, and that's just a minefield. You go to your doctor and spend 10 minutes and get offered HRT. You can go to a naturopath, but that becomes expensive, and they may not be specialized in menopause, or you speak to your girlfriends. And that's why we've actually been so successful, is word of mouth. So people just telling each other about it. And you were saying before that where you work is they're all taking it and talking about it and that kind of stuff. So, but it's still a minority. That information is not out there, unfortunately.
The way I see it is, having my gut issues, I was given obviously medication and ended up in hospital because of the medication. I was passing and vomiting blood because of this medication. Mm. And I thought I was doing the right thing by getting rid of this parasite, even though I was eating healthy and everything. And after that, realized that, which I already knew, and I should have listened to my gut, really. But what you put in is what you look like. And for me, to have a medication to fix a gut issue, I just can't get my head around it. How is a chemical fixing me? It's just not. Sometimes you need some medications. I'm not against that at all. But with this sort of thing, gut and just being healthy and healthy living to get through a stage in life, it totally makes sense that drinking water, eating well, exercising, sleeping, and looking after yourself totally makes sense.
It's almost too simple for people to reconcile that how could this be help? But it's when you really think about it, everyone knows these things, the core building blocks of health. But as you said, though, with medications, and this is a shame as well where we're at, is if you've got an active parasite which is making you sick, there's great medications to suppress that and kill that off. But it's the first stage of a treatment. Then comes the diet, the rebuilding of the microbiome, more plant-based food, putting the good bacteria back in, all these things. But this is where the disconnect is between complementary medicine and medicine. And there's a few integrative doctors now that are working in this space and doing great things. But I still feel that's the big problem. And this is where, as patients, people are suffering because you're only getting one part of the story. And likewise, if you just went to a naturopath, you might take years to get rid of that parasite because we don't have the tools to kill it off quickly. So, you know, it's finding that the balance of practitioners can really help you is a really important thing for anyone that's out there listening too. And it can be really difficult to find those people to help you on that health journey. But what you did is the most powerful thing in anyone's health journey is educating yourself. And nowadays, it's so easy to do that, to go online. And, you know, I'm not talking about Googling symptoms, but that's part of it. You know, people discredit that, but you can learn about, you can actually sometimes self-diagnose too much, but understanding, you know, it's not necessarily about putting a name on something, but understanding what symptoms you have, what's happening in your body is the first stage. And then starting to investigate what different things have been shown to work and what not work. And you're the best doctor that you'll ever have educating yourself, and you carry that knowledge through your life, and it's, and then use your specialist practitioners as you need to. So you've done a fabulous job.
I haven't had any parasite symptoms for 5 years.
Okay.
So, and it's apparently still there. I get tested every now and then, and he's still there. But I don't have any issues with it because I keep my body healthy and I know what can trigger it. So there's no point in me going to that. I wouldn't want to, because it's pretty bad when I get sick. So yeah, healthy living definitely helps. Yeah.
You're certainly a shining example of it, Jodie. And I'm really happy we spoke today about
me too.
Your journey.
Happy skin. Happy skin.
You using happy skin as well?
Yeah.
Okay. Tell us about that. Happy skin. Skin product range for anyone listening.
Yeah, I've only got the exfoliate and it's amazing. So I do that twice a week. And I can't believe the difference. But once again, you know, if you drink your water and you look after yourself, but the happy products. I will be I would like to get more of the products. I'm waiting for my birthday, that's on my list. So I've told the husband, that's where you can buy me. I'd like the whole range. So because once again, it's putting nice goodness on your skin can only help, right?
Well, the secret in the happy skin products are the skin probiotics. So we often destroy them through antibacterials and washes and those kind of things. So everything has its own microbiome. Even an apple has its own microbiome, and that can be destroyed through pesticides and that kind of thing. But everything in nature has its own little symbiotic relationship with microbes, and the skin's exactly the same. So that's why happy skin is doing so well. And you may or may not have picked up on it, but literally tomorrow we launch Happy Collagen, which is the new internal. So very much internal health, external skin products. And then we have the Optimal Skin Guide, which is all the foods that you should be eating. Funnily enough, it's designed that way, is that Optimal Skin Guide. If you have any sort of health condition, you follow that, you're going to improve, because it's just loaded with antioxidants and all nutritious food. Just happens that they're great for the skin, but it's also great for all sorts of other health problems as well. So you put those three things together. But to be honest, you look fabulous because of everything you've been doing. So if you keep doing that, you're going to age beautifully. So well done.
Awesome. Thank you. Looking forward to my 50th. Year and a half to go.
it's a big step. People don't often talk about that too, is that it's for men and women, 50. I'm 50 later this year. And it's a big transitionary point in people's lives, because I've always been on this sort of healthy path, but for a lot of people it's when push comes to shove with health. So anyone listening to this and you're getting close to that age, it's you're never too late as well. You know, we have people in the 80s start adopting healthy living habits. It's never too late. And it's also can seem overwhelming with all this stuff as well. But my advice would be baby steps, be prepared, you know, get organized to make small changes. You know, we've got 8-week programs, another simple thing, our reset program, just different programs that just hold your hand through making those changes, because it's educating. You can't just go from here to here overnight. So slowly, and every little thing that you do, and eventually you get to the point where you really enjoy and you create this wellness lifestyle. So it's not about deprivation, and you'd be surprised, because when you feel great, you're motivated, you want to get up and exercise, and you develop friends that are like-minded, and you know that's how you lead a healthy and happy life. But it can be big changes for many people to get that way. So if you're sort of sitting there thinking, geez, I'm probably in this phase here, it's baby steps, and join our groups, and you know all the advice is free. So
totally do it. It's amazing.
Okay, thanks, Jodie, for your time today. I really appreciate it. And we look forward to seeing you in the groups and chatting there.
Thank you so much. It's been great.